pray together and help and see folks get healed, God. Father, this is something that we are learning and we're growing together in this church. Our teaching, folks stepping up, taking over, and helping out till Miss Sean gets back. And God, just you're such an awesome God because you make things happen. Father, I pray today somebody, if they're lost in any way or if they're struggling with anything, we're not here to judge anybody. I don't like that anyway. But God, I pray their heart will be touched today and they will understand it's not where you've been, what you look like, all this kind of stuff. If it matters to him, it's where you're going. And Father, I pray that anybody today feels a weakness in their body and their heart, let them come to the altar this morning when we finish. And let us pray together because we're together as a church. I just want to thank you again for your, simply for your presence and your unconditional love that you have for us. But today, God, today, I give you all, every bit of the praise and every bit of the glory because you deserve it all, not us. In your almighty name today, Father, amen, amen. Amen. The song we're going to start with is one I think is very appropriate. I love to tell the story. I'll stand to your feet, help us out.
Rescue for sinners and the rest. I get
First. So it's first things first in our life, and he is first in our life. Michael sitting here is another miracle today. What he went through with his surgery and stuff, and he still looks good. Did I say that? I'm sorry. I mean, Sean, God's working miracles through her, and Tina, things going to happen with Tina. I can hear Tina now laying in the bed up there at the hospital, wherever she's going to be at, and straighten them out as they come in the door. Do you know Jesus? This Sunday sermon song for you, buddy. But first thing first is God. You ready?
Amen. All the things that I have held dear, the vanities that whispered in my ear, what would I do if they all disappeared? Riches and fame and all that they could buy, I've come to find they never satisfy. What would I gain if my soul's a prize? I don't want to love what the world loves. I don't want to chase what the world does. I only want you. I only want you. First things first.
What the world loves, I don't want to chase what the world does. I only want you. I only want you. First things first, I seek your will, not my own. Surrender all my wants to you, and keep the first things.
God. Y'all know how this goes. Come on, help us out with this. Yeah, let me say amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord. Woo.
Amen.
Amen. Hey, Larry, you still over there? I am a friend of God.
Yes, I am.
I am a friend of God.
Yes,
what about you, Mike?
I
am a friend of God. He calls me friend. Come
yes,
on, Mike.
Yes, he does. Yes, he does. Oh, yes, he does. Oh, yes, I am. Oh, yes, I am.
I am a friend of God. He calls me friend.
Yes, he does.
Here we go.
Oh, yes, he
does. I am a friend of God.
Oh, yes, I am.
I am a friend of God. He calls.
Keep going.
Friend.
All right, we'll stop. God bless you guys. All right, thank y'all. Thank you, Lord, for giving us these songs today. Easton, you did a great job. All right, you go back out there. With, you know, you ain't got to stay up here. Takes after Papa, don't he? They want to hang out. Y'all give all these kids a real big hand. They did a great job. That's the knucklehead. He'll tell you real quick, you're a knucklehead and me. That's what he'll do. I'm not going to apologize, but I am for no bulletins. Like I said, Sean, we've been in ICU for a couple weeks, and we will be back on the bulletin routine next week, and everything else will kind of start. We got some things worked out this weekend to take care of that. Mike wants to say something.
All right, this will be really quick. For those who are unfamiliar, I'm actually the rabbi for the House of New Beginnings Messianic Synagogue. It meets here on Saturday afternoons. We are having our corporate Passover celebration next Sunday afternoon at 2 p.m. I highly encourage everybody to come. We have a sign-up sheet out in the lobby where the prayer requests normally are. If you're going to come, please sign up. We need to make sure we have enough things for the Seder for everybody. And if you want to sign up to bring some food or something, please see me before you decide what you want to bring, because there are some special regulations concerning bringing stuff for Passover. So, like I said, please see me if you want to sign up. And I highly encourage everybody who wants to come, please join us. That is next Sunday at 2 p.m.
I'll give Mike a big hand. Y'all need to come to that, okay? We have partnered up with our Jewish brothers and sisters. In the Bible, it talks about the Gentiles and the Jewish folks coming together. And Mike just happened to be in our praise team, so I guess they made him rabbi because he was with us. I don't know. I'm just kidding. Dennis and I went and played at that. Is that what we went and played at last time? Dennis and I went over there before, and we killed Mike's battery. Remember? We killed his battery in the rain. But we did. We had a really good time. It was just super awesome. I'm just going to remind you that we have Sunday school at 7 at 9:30 every Sunday morning, and then I come up here, or whoever's preaching, usually me, but we kind of come together, and that's why I was tearing her right there, because I love her. It's my baby granddaughter right there. One of many that I have, but that's my baby one right now. Look here. So anyway, Sunday evening, which will be today, me and a cat will be hanging out. 5 o'clock, we're going back to do another service tonight. Today, we're going to be in Job chapter 27, verses 1 through 11, and then tonight from 12 to the end of that chapter. So come on, it's really good stuff we're doing. So don't forget now, we're in chapter 27, but we're going all the way through all 42 chapters. We're going to cover this whole book, you know, like Sean was covering Revelation again, until we got all the way to the end of it. Some things we need to hear. We don't want to hear, but we're going to hear it anyway. Did I say that? Yeah, I did. Remind you about Tuesday night's Bible study. It's a potluck, and you folks, whatever you got in your pocket, pot at the house, food-wise, and just bring it, and we'll eat it on Tuesday nights. Everybody will eat on Tuesday nights. And I try to eat last, but it's not happening very well. So y'all come and support that team. I'm not here every night right now, and I probably won't be this week during the week, but I'll be back, I think, the next week. Depends on her healing. Wednesday food pantry, I think we fed 260-something, was it, last week? In 2 hours, we do this, in just 2 hours worth of food pantry.
Huh? Anyway, we had a bunch, over 200. Yeah. 211. Oh, amen.
That's not, we had about 10 to 12 families that didn't show up because of this master's week. And some of them families had 10 to 12 people in each.
So wow.
Yeah, we probably had a 275 if everybody was showing up.
Leslie, didn't we have like 5 or 6 new families this week?
That was last week. We had like 8 new families. And I think we had 2 new families this week. But it is spreading.
And remember last year in 23, we fed over 8,000 people.
Right, we're almost
to that now.
Yeah. Yeah.
We feed a whole lot. You better give us some bigger numbers then. I was just checking. Just picking at you.
We still need some volunteers. So, young men, women are showing you out right now. And so are the kids.
I thought she was looking at Russ for a minute. You said young man. He perked right up. He did. You said young man. Russ did this right here. He went. Okay, be nice. We're in church, yes.
Yeah. We got some buses that can help us out. Be glad to. We all come.
Thank you, Leslie.
You're welcome.
Come back and see us. And on Thursday nights, I'm doing a video podcast type thing. It's a life coaching program that we're doing. Russ kind of got me pushed on that. Motivational, spiritual life coaching is what we're doing. And inviting an addiction, too. We talk about that. And we're just trying to help everybody that we can. Just a lot of stuff going on. And don't forget about this Friday night. How could I miss that?
Right.
You won't be here next week, will you?
You don't
miss it. Your dad's going to come fill in for you.
He's going to be with me.
Oh.
Right.
Okay, I guess I'll be here.
We got
this. Tina and Jerry, thank you for starting this whole book right here. The TNGC's 100 Envelope Savings Challenge. Now, where there's a one, you put in a $1. And it goes all the way to 100. Figure out the rest. It's not hard to figure it out. So, as you can tell, people have been putting money in it, but there's still plenty of spaces left.
Amen.
When we get through filling this book up, because we're trying to raise more money for our building fund, I'm going to get back on that job or that business this week about the property and all we're in the process of getting. When we fill this book up, we've raised $5,050. We'll take a couple bucks out of your pocket if you want to drop a C note in there, that's fine, or whatever. Just drop it in here in a space where it's asked for that, or we'll make more room for you. Now, this 100 envelope savings challenge is a bonus challenge. So what does that mean? If you want to give
your... If they can't fit it in that book because the spaces is already taken, we'll take it in that
book. I notice you got a big money bag in this book. Yeah.
That's my book.
Take it.
That's your book?
Yeah, that's my book.
Well, you're still living at home? I'm going to put it under here and protect it for you. Anyway, y'all, please. Matter of fact, I'll take the book to the front today, and one of our folks will. And if you'd like to give it to that, please give to it. And be sure that we write get y'all's name written down, too, as well. So Cindy's in charge of that today.
Okay.
Just let you know that I say that.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
I got
you. Yeah, it's right here. You know where it's at.
Uh-huh.
Okay, so prayer requests. We're going to take care of these real quick. Wow, Talisha's kids filled the open sleeves. Wow, the kids did this. $80, man. How about that? That's
pretty cool. Amen.
Amen.
Praise the Lord. He does everything like that. You got to watch. There's a whole list of stuff here. I won't go through them all, but thank you for that. And again, thank you for you folks that have handed Sean and I like gift cards. And you know, y'all getting our food train going since she's been in ICU so much. Being sure that we're going to be fed when she's home. And they're also fixing meals that are set for healthy heart and diabetes to make sure, because she can only eat certain things. So whatever's left at our house, I'll finish that too.
Amen.
Sorry, Chris, I might call you over if I got extra.
I got you.
You don't need any more.
Nikki said, uh-oh.
She cooked the other night. Anyway, we're going to lift up Sean today, if we could, for healing and also for the Lord to perform what he does miracles-wise and to take her through this heart surgery she's going to have this coming week and then the other part of the heart surgery in 5 weeks. So I'll keep you up on that the best I can, but that's as deep as I can get into it right now with that. Cindy Seafelt, Sean for healing, Pat, myself for strength, thank you, and our church family, all the sick and the suffering, Tina and herself for guidance and strength, and also want to pray for Israel too, okay? There's a lot of stuff going on. Prayers for our church, family, sick and suffering, and the situations that we're working on here, and any kind of situation from Brother Thomas, he's stating. Kevin and Jess, Jess is not feeling well. I pray for her to be healed from her sickness. Also, and they said their children, grandchildren, Teresa and Scott, Paul and Andrea, myself and Sean, the government, amen, Amanda and Mark and Virginia for doctor's appointments, and then Mark's dad for healing. And then Brother Mike for this mic over here, the guy with the wrong color shirt on. It's orange. It's not. Somebody get him a red shirt, would you? A little black around the red, you know, collar. So. Put the G on the pocket while you're at it. So. Thank you, Hunter. You're a good man. Tina and the kids. There we go. You are now wrapped into Georgia stuff now. And you're covered by the blood of Jesus, too, by the way. It's, see, there's more red right there. It's all good, yeah. Feels pretty good? Go back to sleep. All right, and also Tina's upcoming surgery this Friday. She's going to be the same place that Sean and I are going to be this week, so I'll come see you. It'll be like kind of easy. They said, well, you can't go see everybody. I said, I got a badge in my truck that can take me anywhere I want in the hospital. Right, Gary?
That's right.
Because I got Gary one. He's helping me out with his hospital visits, and it works, buddy. I walk in, they say, who are you? I said, well, come on in, sir. Yes, ma'am. I love it when they say, are you the doctor? Depends on what kind you need. I did that the other day with somebody. Had a good time with it. But anyway, Leslie, continue prayers for Sean and myself, prayers for Tina's upcoming surgery, and to continue healing for Mike. Prayers for Harley. She's starting to have the drop seizures again and waiting on a neurology appointment. So, Harley, you stay strong like bull and run like chicken. Okay, she smiled on that one. That's what I tell Easton all the time. Cindy D., prayers for myself and Sean. Thank you, Miss Cindy, and all the people at TNDC, and all my love for the coming up surgeries, and for her upcoming surgeries. I'm sorry, and then for baby Jaden, and then the Soltz. I talked with Brother Leonard last night. His mother is in the hospital at AU, I believe, as well. We're praying for them. Is this two pages? I got to flip it over. Okay. David Alexander for Miss Sean and healing, myself, thank you for rest. Josh, pray that you get this job and at
Kroger.
Which one?
The one here on 150
Grove. Okay. If you go to the one on Columbia Road, I was going to go up there and talk to somebody. But.
Not that far. Can't walk that far.
You're going by Alexander Drive. I know what you're talking about now. So anyway, we pray that you get that job as well. Miss Kathy for Pastor and myself and Sean, and then Martha's brother-in-law, and then Israel, and our country, and then her family's walk with God and our church family at TNGC, Jenny Newman and family, and I got something from Jenny, too, I need to take care of. And then Allison, praying for Bob for healing, and then Sean and myself. Thank you, Miss Allison. Deb, all the praise goes to God, prayer for myself and Sean, fast recovery, all who attend TNGC and all the sick and the shut-in of the children, grand and great-grands. Jeannie, prayers for travel mercies this Friday for CJ's dad. He's coming down from Vermont,
yes.
Okay, and family as they will be here for a week. And Jeannie said we're going to try to get him in church a little bit, you know, love on him. So it's a surprise for and Tina for her surgery, and then for Miss Sean, so listen up, Miss Sean for her surgery as well, and then for Tina's surgery, and then for me, and then for Mom and Daddy, Jerry and Dennis, and then Mike and the kids, and Judy and Kay. We're just lining them up. And Bubba, as for his grandmother, is 90 years old, in the hospital with multiple issues. Jenny Newman has asked prayer for her and her family experiencing the second loss of a child. Gracie and Archer are with Jesus now. Also prayers for the two nephews, Weston and Andrew, ages 4 and 1. They had a procedure in Atlanta, having hip dysplasia. I got it right, Leslie, because I wrote it so I could get it right. Yeah. Okay. And so both of them are in cast for the next 4 weeks. In prayer for a little pain during healing. Praying for little pain during healing for these guys. And then for the parents, don't stress and worry, parents. It's going to be okay. God's already got it took care of. Anyhow. Anna, for some unspoken, thanks for all the victories recently. Amen. I'm not sure what they all are, but it don't matter because God put them there.
Amen.
Yeah, man, that's right. All right, let's see. We got Miss Tammy. Good to see you again. You're doing a little better?
I'm doing a lot better, thank you.
Don't turn your head real quick toward Jim, okay? That's how we spread the word, right?
Yeah.
Right. The church is supposed to go out and spread the word of the Lord, right? Yeah. Let's go out and be disciples for Christ. When you accept Jesus Christ, you become one of the team.
Yes.
You know, you're a child of God. You got to go out and do your part. You know, he didn't create this world for us to get all messed up in it. He created for us to live in it and witness to others and bring them closer to him. Amen?
Amen.
I'm sorry. Amen?
Amen.
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 Oh, you got weak on the third one. It's too much air, wasn't it? It's all good. It's all good. Okay, we got Tammy. Anyway, we're going to lift you up, Miss Sean, and Cassie,
Casey Bryan,
and then the kids and grandkids, and Aunt Nancy, and Lawrence Davis for family finance and for light bill and food and health and reuniting with a daughter after 32 years. Wow.
Wow.
Yeah, amen on that. I'll reunite with mine, they'll run the other way. Anyway, I'll stop being funny. Let's go to the Lord in prayer if we could. Father God, you've heard each and every one of these requests, Lord. Father, you know what's going on much better than I. And Lord, we've asking for healing of those folks that are in the hospitals and are trying to get through some times right now, Lord, that they're struggling with. Be with those we pointed out this morning on the prayer list, Lord, that just need a little bit of love. They need some healing. They need a great physician hands upon them. And be with the technicians and nurses and doctors and all those that are involved, Lord, if you would, in helping these folks and treating them. Father, I pray that you lay your healing hands upon those folks so that they will do your work, Lord, because it's just what we need you to do, period. But, Lord, be with the families that are going through anything, children that are struggling with anything, just things that, God, that need to be taken care of, but we write these down on our prayer list so that we can remember that we, as Christians, need to be praying for these people daily. We might not know every single thing that's going on in our life or in somebody's life, but what we do know is that God hears our prayer, and he heals those that are sick. And God, I want to claim victory over every bit of that today. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
So anyway, we're going to keep moving forward here. I'm gonna send this song out to Sean because I know she's watching right now. So you guys just kind of hang on here a minute. Let me find this other version. Oh, that's a bigger print. I can see that. Okay. Sean, this goes out to you, and I hope you enjoy it. I like doing it because it's all about God. Anytime, David.
Mary, did walk on water, Mary. Did you know that your baby boy would save our sons and daughters? Did you know that your baby boy has come to make you new? This child that you deliver will soon deliver you, Mary. That your baby boy will give sight to a blind man, Mary. Did you know that your baby boy would calm a storm with his head? Did you know that your baby boy has walked where angels trod? When you kiss your little baby, you kiss the face of God. And the blind will see, and the deaf will hear, and the dead will live again.
Thank the Lord for just a great day already. We're going to go to Job chapter 27. Let's get on into the word right now. Let's not drag our feet on this one. This is a good one today, real good one. If you got your Bibles, turn to chapter 27 in the book of Job. If you can't find it, think about your job. Did you get that? Yeah, that was corny, wasn't it?
Yeah.
So is that cat hanging out your pocket?
I know what I
Okay,
mean.
Fine. Wear that to the hospital so they'll have something to talk about. Other than, never mind, I won't say that. Quick prayer, let's bow our heads. Father God, thank you for being with us today, Lord. Thank you for what you're doing, healing all these folks, Lord. Father, continue to heal everybody, if you would, Lord. In Jesus' name, I want to claim that today. And Father, I want to ask that you'll be with me these next few verses, Lord. I'll be able to bring it to folks today that will have a better understanding of how to deal with this life that we live in right now. Father, it's not about us, but it's about our decisions that we make. And Father, I give you all the praise and all the glory. Amen and amen. This is kind of an overview. Job's speech as a natural and future development of his previous reflections. You know, Job had some reflections before when his friends were trying to take him down, basically. Job expresses and defends his purity and his heart, firmness and perfect innocence, and that's what he calls it. Remember Eliphaz, Zophar, and Bildad, they put Job down so bad. But Job was a great man. Remember, he was a great man. He was one of, matter of fact, I believe the Lord had put it to where Job was closer to a perfect man as a man could be outside of Jesus Christ. Remember a few weeks ago on Easter, I believe I spoke about the similarities between Job and Jesus, how we kind of broke it down to see kind of how they were, and there's a lot of similarities. It could be with us too. A whole lot more of similarities with us and Jesus.
But we have to do our part. God's done his part. Amen?
Amen.
This today is going to be talking about integrity. Integrity is a quality of honesty, strong moral principles, and moral uprightness. These things are very important. Our integrity, we fight with it every day. And us guys really fight with the pride problem. I don't need you. I got this. Go on, God. Yeah, if you get in trouble, who you going to call? God, would you please help me? And he goes, man, I ain't never left you to fool it. They ain't see me. He's right here all the time. All the time. He don't, look, God don't sit on my shoulder over here. He sits on my shoulders. And he said, see what you do, boy. And that's when you get, Joel, listen. Joel. When God's sitting on your shoulders, you think Sean Gibbs slapped you in the back of the head? Wait till he hits you. I just want to let you know that. I was thinking about you. Not really, but I was thinking about you anyway. Moreover, and continued his parable, parable being a simple story or a spiritual lesson, if you would. The word parable, and this is in verse 1, moreover, Job continued his parable. The word parable, as used here, refers to a comparison of one thing with another, thereby making it simple for all to understand. If the simpler we keep it, easier it is to understand it. You know why? Because we're too busy complicating things in our life. We're too busy trying to figure it out ourselves when God's already taking care of it, for goodness sakes. We got to do our part. We got to follow the word of God. We got to follow every step that he has put in front of us, the path which he has laid out for us. We're either going to stay on the path or we're going to fall over in the ditch and take a couple days to get out of it. But he's still standing there doing this. I got you. Come on. But then you're sitting there going, I'm in the ditch. You let me fall in the hole. And he said, I got you. Give me your hand. What we're not realizing is that you fell in your own hole because you put yourself there. He didn't. He created you and gave you a perfect life. Who messed it up? We did. God will mess up anything. With God, all things are possible, not with man. Okay? But just understand how simple life really is. In verse 2, it talks about, as God lives, who has taken away my judgment? And the Almighty who has vexed, in other words, vexed means frustrated my soul, basically. That's what it's saying here. Which is obvious, but yet Job still doesn't know the reason. So Job stated to God that he had made his soul bitter. Does God ever make you feel bitter? Huh? Does he ever God being right? I mean, of course, he better not be. I'm saying that because you're allowing that to happen. And you shouldn't allow it to happen. That's not how it works, okay? So it's obvious what Job was going through here. As Job complained about God, he then states that he goes to God still anyway. He does that because God will never leave you nor forsake you. He's the same yesterday, today, and forever. He's always there. Psalm 46:10, again, be still and know that I am God. Be still. We can't be still in the world because we're too busy trying to live the ways of the world instead of living for God. When we go to the hospitals and we have things done to our bodies and they got all these other humans out there with knives and all kind of stuff going to cut us and sew us up and all that, you know, we're scared. Why are we afraid? Sean looked at me the other night, and I know you're watching, looked at me the other night, and, well, let me back up from that. We were talking about when God gets ready to take us home. She said, let me tell you right now, if God takes me home this week, I know where I'm going. I'm okay. I am really okay with where I'm at and where I'm going. Now, my wife's sitting there telling me this, and I'm going, good gracious, praise the Lord. She said, but I ain't going nowhere. I said, what'd you tell it to me after that for then? She said, because I'm going to aggravate you until you can't take it home. That's when I should have called you, Shane, for some really deep prayer over the phone loudly so she could have heard what you said. That would have got me out of it, but it didn't. It didn't work. I couldn't. Well, I didn't call him. That's my fault. But anyway, you know, you got to look at Job. He goes to God still, no matter what, as we must go to God still, no matter what. Verse 3 says, all the while my breath is in me and the Spirit of God is in my nostrils. How about breathe in, breathe out. Breathe God in, send him out to go help others. Breathe more God in, Give it to others. Breathe more of God in, give it to others. I don't know if I could do that to a rabbi. Could I? I hope not. You already got all that, right? I love you, Mike. You've been a good friend up to this point. Despite his calamity, he is still alive, and the Spirit of God is still in him. Job is what they're talking about. He will now give a ringing defense of his own position. See, Job is basically saying, no matter what happened to him, I want to hold fast to my integrity, which again is the quality of being strong. It's a strong principle to have, honesty, being able to stay focused on God. Okay? There's another word here coming up. We're going to use the word deceit in just a minute. I want you to be sure you know that's what they call a practice of deceiving. So, and that a lot of that goes on in the world today simply because Satan's on the run around us. He's trying to keep us down. Verse 4 says, my lips shall not speak weakness, nor my tongue utter deceit. A practice of deceiving causes someone to believe that something is not true. I was told last night that about a young lady, I think she's 21. Her family, she's in church now because one of my kids has helped her. But she's with a family that's just kind of discombobulated. I'm going to use that word, okay? Just kind of mixed up, okay? This girl, before she got in church, one of my daughters has been taking her to church because she's living with them right now because she can't go with her parents because she can't deal with it. I think her dad passed her and mom's still doing stuff. But anyway, she was an atheist. An atheist, Chris, before, and Shane, before they ever talked to her about church, my other daughter. She said, Dad, this kid gets up every Sunday morning now and gets us and makes sure we're ready to go to church. You tell me God don't work in somebody's heart. But you know why that's happening? Because God is allowing him to work through our kids to help these other kids that don't. All our kids are not the same. They're different. They're raised differently, some of us. But we're raised the same. We're raised by God. Nothing changes. What changes? We change. And when we change, the world is really messed up. When somebody heard that we had the Jews and the Gentiles coming together at Three Nails Gospel Church, I said, and get over it. I could care less what you think about that. I know what the Word of God says. You got a problem with that? Look here, I use this as a double-edged sword, and I'll use it as a hammer if I need to. I got a bigger one than this at the house, and it's heavy. I'll bring it. My God has got a precious, awesome, powerful word. They don't have to carry nothing around. I do. I'm going to be sure I get the right stuff out of this book. You know what I'm saying? If I'm going to cook up a meal to serve you, I want to be sure I got the right ingredients there. I want to be sure I'm putting the right dietary stuff on your plate. Amen. Love God, rebuke the devil. Got to do it right. If you're not going to do it right, why are you even doing it? Don't try to do what you think is right if you're not sure if it's right. Because then all you're doing is lying to God. Because see, you know that's what really gets me, Dennis, is some of these people out there in the world, they'll go and try to do things. Well, I'm doing what God wants me. No, you're doing what you want to do. If you knew what God wanted you to do, you wouldn't be doing what you're doing now. They know better, but they go do it anyway. What I say several sermons back, hundreds of thousands of people in this world know who God is. They know who Jesus Christ is, but they don't want to acknowledge him. Why? Because they're having too much fun living in the world. And be honest with you, I think it's because they're afraid. They are afraid to be wrong. With God, you can't be nothing but right. You go to court, you got to deal with things. That's just the judge that's being paid to sit in a courtroom and make a decision about our lives because we messed up somewhere and we can't make the decision right. If we could, we wouldn't have made the first one in the first place. And things would be different in our life. We have got to adjust our hearts toward God and get it away from the world and man because that doesn't make anything better. God, it makes it all better. Mow better. I ain't talking about cutting no grass either. I heard him over there. He's on. Don't let him stay right. Be sure he keeps that red and black jacket on though. Let your lips speak no weakness, none. You know, when people speak negative of things, when people think speak positive of things, more than likely that a negative is going to jump out at somebody because that's what we're used to. But if you speak positive and use God's word in that way, guess what? When you don't, and don't speak darkness of where some light is, because the darkness is not. It is not going to overcome the light, because the light is going to overcome the darkness every time. We must know how God works. And the only way to do that is be in his word. Let me tell you, I got a lot of rest this week. Not really, but I sat a lot. And I watched and I listened, Dennis. And I did a lot of thinking. I even took a little microscope, a little thing I could look like a binocular, and a single one. Was up in that big building. I was watching all them people walk up down the road. Master's Week, you know, you want to see. But I thought, they ain't serving the same master I am. We're serving the right master during Master's Week, and that's our Almighty God. Amen? Come on, put your hands together for the Lord. It ain't for me. It's for him and all for him. I've been saying that for a long time. Master's Week is at. Why can't every Sunday be an Easter? What did I say a couple weeks ago? Every Sunday's going to be Easter from now on. If that's the case, you fill the place up. You know why I got a big praise team up here? So in case y'all don't come, we still got so much of seats we can fill up. I ain't dumb. I've been around 2 days at least. I'm just kidding about that. Well, no, I'm not. I guess I'm not. God is good. Look here. He maintains his correctness, Job does, of position. Even from the beginning, when the Lord did finally appear, when he finally appeared to Job, he did not contradict Job's statement. So as long as Job lives, he asserts that he will not lie. He is not going to be wicked by sayings, or by saying things, if you would, that are not true. Okay? Verse 5 says, "Go, God forbid that I should justify you. Till I die, I will not remove my integrity from me." Job's hanging in there. The certainty of a position, irrespective of whatever circumstances that are there, can be maintained only if it's fully based on the word of God. Job was an upright man, both in his heart and his life, through the grace of God bestowed on him. And his... Look, Job's whole attitude changed. That's where I'm going with this thing. Because he saw that God was there for him. God attacked him. He put stuff upon him. Okay? That's what it seemed like to him. And he solicited things in a way to Job. Look, there was just so much through the grace of God to persist therein to the end of Job's life. Okay? God was always there no matter what. It don't matter whether you're Jewish. It don't matter whether you're Baptist. Well, if we got enough chairs in the back, it'll be Baptist. That's what they said. If you're Baptist, you're Methodist. None of this matters. What really gets me, I'm trying my best not to leave this pulpit, but I think that ain't going to happen. Like right now, right now. That's what, oh, don't let me echo because it'll go all the way down this way, but it'll go down the street. I don't care. Why do we think we got to know everything? What I'm saying, Michael, how much do you know the Bible?
Don't answer.
I'm just using you as a, not a dummy, as a friend. He said, well, I know it pretty good. And then we start talking. I'll go, well, wait a minute, that ain't what Scripture says. And you'll go, well, then teach me. But some people don't do that, the last thing I said. Most people in that category will tell you that they know everything about the Bible because they read it all of the time. I can read all the time too, Shane. I can read every day. I don't like reading, but I love reading the Bible. But here's the deal right here. Don't go talking a bunch of stuff you think that the way that you comprehended it until you can sit with somebody that really knows the words. I can really mess you up and get Mike up here and speak all kind of Hebrew to you. And you're going to look at me going, what did he just say? I said, sit down. He'll explain it to you later. Point is this right here, okay? You got to follow God the way that God wants you to follow him. Don't go out and try to get all this credit for what you think you did. I stood in this pulpit now for 10 years. I am not going to take any credit whatsoever for anybody that ever got saved at an altar or anywhere on their knees in the street. I don't care where they at. I am not going to take that credit because it is not mine. I am there for God to utilize me for his good, not my good.
My God will take care of you. He will change your life if you change your life. But see, God's waiting for you to say, I'm ready to change, God. Show me what to do. Carry me down that path. How you doing, Pastor Banks? He is right there all the time, ready just to carry you in his arms. Right, Robbie? I love you, man. Oh, you got a grip today. I got to go. Anyway. That boy. You've been lifting weights with Chuck, ain't you? Look. God will take care of every part of your life if you allow him to do so. When we go visit people in the hospital, what do they want, Gary? Don't answer. You and I both know what they want. They want us to come in and pray over them to make them feel better. Okay? But see, their faith is what heals them. I'm taking my stuff. I'm going to watch, man. Good try, Robbie. That was good. Because they want somebody to be there and show them the love of God. Because when you get in a weak situation, they get weaker. And then we walk in to start praying, and they're going, oh, man, I feel better already. How many times you done that, Shane? Then they'll walk in and pray with somebody, and they go, thank you, I feel so much better. I love it when they say, can you put us on your prayer list? I love to tell them this, Jane. Nope, but we'll pray right now, and then I'll put you on the prayer list. I love praying with people. I do. I love getting them as soon as they say it. Usually when they call me, I just need to get you on the prayer list. You put me on the prayer list. I want you to pray for us this week. I said, well, don't hang up. We're going to pray before I hang up or you hang up. And we're going to have that prayer started right now. It's called a prayer chain. And we're going to do it. We'll call some more people and make it happen. You know, let me tell you something. Prayer chain. Check that out. Okay? I'm just kind of throwing some stuff at you right now. My wife's friend, her best friend, lives in Ohio. She's been calling all week, wanting to see how her best friend was doing. Not Sean, but her friend Susan. She lives in Ohio, like I said. She called the other day, and she said, as soon as she gets home after this stuff, after the first surgery, I'm coming to Augusta. Driving to Augusta, Georgia. I said, how long are you going to be with us? She said, until she's healed. That's friendship. That's true love as a friend, best friend. That's a dedicated Christian on top of that. That's what people should do all the time. Be there for your friend. I am a friend of God. Well, if you're a friend of God, do what a friend does. If you're a friend of God, then you follow God like you should, and he give you a little more God. God Almighty, Lord of glory. He's something else, ain't he? I love this stuff. Verse 7 says, let my enemy be as wicked and he who rises up against me as the unrighteous. This is what they call a bold statement. But Job is right. The truth of the matter is that the three friends were wicked and therefore unrighteous. The three we've been talking about. Okay. Anyone who would be his enemy, the Hebrew means hater. Am I close? Just tell me yes. Thank you. And then there's the hopelessness of a hypocrite. I don't reckon we got no hypocrites in this place. I hope not. Oh, yeah. Yeah, for what is the hope of the hypocrite? Though he has gained when God takes away his soul. What shall it profit a man if he shall gain the whole world and lose his own soul? Amen. Mark 8:6, I believe 8:36. Here, Job, see, right here, Job looked upon the condition of a hypocrite and a wicked man to be the most miserable people. Want to be miserable? Follow that right there, I'll tell you right now. Verse 9 says, will God hear his cry when trouble comes upon him? Only if he truly repents. I didn't touch nothing. God will reveal himself. He will also reveal your righteousness to them that might see themselves in your light. Now, Chris Brunson had said that so many times when we were doing the prediction meetings up here, and Jerus and all of us, and Paul. And Chris always said, I want them to see him in me. And I remember that, Chris. Every week you did that, and it stuck with me. And I'm like, dadgummit. And I've heard it more since then, but maybe it's because your fault. You started all that. God bless you, Chris. I hope your ministries are still going good, too, as well. Look here. God does not play games with us, okay? Will he delight himself in the Almighty? You know who we're talking about, Job. Or will he always call upon God?
Hypocrisy alienates God from us and alienates us from God. See, such of these things cannot have delight in the Almighty. But God is only to be called upon, and it becomes all man to call upon him for all blessings and temporal things and spiritual things. We have to make a choice. We call upon God when we need him. God did not create you and walk away from you. God created you, and he walks with you everywhere that you go. He does not create you and walk away. He said, I created you. There you go. Good luck. Have a good day. I'm done. I hope you're going to be all right. And then that's when you get out there and you start praying. You get all crying and stuff. And you're going to get all mushy and all these things. Guess what's going to happen? Why don't you get real with God and learn that the sins that you're committing, you don't need them anyway. You need God so you don't do that junk no more. Amen. Y'all got to get excited, church, and let have fun. Not for me, but you got to get excited about God. It's a privilege to come to church. Nobody making you come. It's a privilege to get up on a Sunday morning and say, I'm going to church today. I've been excited all week because I knew I was coming to church today. My wife, I didn't use the word I was going to use, killed her. I'm going to say that. But it about tore her up because she couldn't get up and come to church. You think, can I just go to church? No, you're not. I don't need you to be around all these people. I said, look, those folks that want you to stay home so you could be all right and be protected, and that's what we're doing here. Okay? God protects us every day. Yes, sir. You're my sweetheart, too, Robert. Chuck, good to see you. You're my sweetheart, too. Let go. Look, God is so real, man. She's watching today. Several people watching today. We all need prayer. Pastor Banks needs prayer. I need prayer. Shane needs prayer. Carolyn needs prayer. All of us in the ministry. Russ, all of us. Gary, all of us. We need prayer. When somebody's down, pray for them. God hears every single prayer that you pray, and he takes care of the situation. And look here, I'm going to say it like this, and if I'm wrong, y'all don't throw nothing, but just don't worry about it. But if I'm wrong, look here. God takes care of what he needs to take care of. Just because you ask it don't mean he's going to do it your way. He's going to do it his way. You know, Yahweh, you get that? Good. You'll do Yahweh. Yahweh. Man, look, my God, you know, that Robbie said, I'm his sweetheart. You know what? I love that young man right there. He is a walking miracle. How was he sitting before he had that surgery? All like this, wasn't he? Sitting straight up in that chair now, like that, yeah. Now, yeah, he was watching the guys driving by, wasn't he? Yeah. Now y'all got a van and everything. God has blessed you with so much, man. Praise the Lord. It means a lot when you can notice what God's doing for you. If you're not noticing what God's doing for you, then you're trying to live your very own little teeny life, and what's that going to do? Let me tell you something. If you knew what you was doing and you really had God in the first place, then you will drop all the junk in your path and get it out of the way and live your life for God, and you don't have to carry all this junk around anymore, and you can walk just a good path and go, thank you, Lord.
Amen.
I know how it is. I done been down this road, y'all. Man, Russ, all them shows we've done in the past. We was not in this business. But now we say hallelujah and praise the Lord and say it. Instead of, get that guy that's loud a triple shot of whatever he's drinking, he'll shut up. And why would? I would do that back then. And he'd pass out. Wouldn't bother me a bit because he got quiet. And then, Larry, the same guy walks into church one day. Oh, hi, Pastor. I said, ooh, I remember you. That's my fault, wasn't it? Imagine the people that come in here that I entertained all those years. Yes. It was fun. Made money. But you know what? I have not yet found a casket big enough to hold all the money that I made. Because I don't need one. It's right here, baby. Right here. What? Look, I already heard when you go, you're going to put everything you got in the casket with you.
That's right.
I know, yeah. That's all right. I want to see you put that motorhome in there. I'm going to watch that one. I ain't never seen a hearse pulling a U-Haul, and I ain't never seen a motorhome in a hearse. That makes sense? You get all that?
No.
It's not a dot. I told you.
Lyle, if you would. Verse 11 says this right here. I will teach you by the hand of God. I will teach you by the hand of God. That which is with the Almighty, I will not conceal. Job claims his words are now inspired of the Lord. We can find real purpose in life by worshiping the one and only true God, Jehovah, unless he reveals them. We are encouraged to give him praise and honor and obedience that he deserves. We are to give God every one of those things, all of those things. Respect God. Fear God. Fearing God is reverence and respect. Fearing anything else is literally fear. You're scared, you're afraid, your emotions, your feelings get all out of whack and messes your head up so you can't think straight. Fear the Lord is wisdom from a man that speaks it. Go ahead. I walk around this room and hand this mic to any one of these guys right now. They can just put it right out there on you. My God is great. Your God is great. What Job went through in his life, I guarantee you it ended up pretty good for him. How's your life going to end up today? Do you know Jesus Christ is your Lord and Savior? When somebody tells you the price has been paid, you ain't got to pay nothing. He's already paid for your life. I said this to one day when my daughter was sitting back there. You know, it took me a long time to say this, Dennis, but I said, I'd give my daughter's life for y'all right now. Just like God did for Jesus. I'm not God and I'm not Jesus. But you know what? I did a lot, put a lot of thought into that. And that child heard me. She was sitting right there. She told me the next day on the phone. She called me. She said, Daddy, where do I need to take my body? Woo! This is a girl that was in addiction for over 15 years. But she's willing to do that. Just out of this, like this. Why? Because her heart is right. That is important. Where you at in your home? You wonder why stuff comes in your house? Because you open the door too wide. Don't let it in. Every time you go buy something and put it in your house, who's had their hands on it? Isn't that right? Who's had their hands on it? You don't know how many people touched that thing. Devil done had his hands all over that materialistic stuff. You don't need anything. God will provide all things. You know what? Sometimes, Miss Jackie, I just wish we could go back to the days of dirt and logs and grass roofs. Not roots, roofs. And live the hard way. And so we could appreciate what God has given us as a luxury, if you would. To me, God's luxury is life. He's given us life. Amen?
Amen.
Life is what he gives us. And he gave us and is going to continue to give us every single day of our life. But we have got to show our appreciation and our love by following him. Get off of the track of the non-substance path that you're on. Get on a path that is productive. That means follow God and you will be lifted up more ways than you'll ever know. It's hard for some people to understand that, Pastor Banks. But if people would pay attention to God and know that he takes care of all things. All things. Then he's going to see how it works. Amen?
Amen.
He's going to take you right through the roughest and toughest times you'll ever encounter in your life. People want a purpose. Well, if you got a passion and God's given you a gift, there's your passion. Okay? There is your purpose. God gives you a purpose, each one of us. We go, we come to the altar, we get on the knee, and we pray. And the next thing we know, we're feeling pretty good for about 2 weeks. And then something happens. You know what happens? You made another wrong choice. If you're going to go to God and be sure you accept Christ or go up and rededicate your life or try to turn yourself around, you got to follow. Look, if somebody works for you and you hire them, you're not going to say, okay, you're hired. Here's your keys. Go run the business. Now, what you're going to do is you're going to train them. Listen to me. You're going to train them. Come with me, young man. I'm going to train you for about a week. And get out of here, Satan. I ain't got time for you. I'm going to train you for about a week. Then I'm going to hand you the keys. Well, what do you think God's doing with the Word? He's training each one of us every single day. How much we? Bible talks about when you work for somebody, do the best you can for them. That's respectful to God. He tells you to be like that, especially when you're going to work for somebody. Don't let them put you down. The day that I went and told the VP of the company that I needed to go speak at a recovery. Faith Home is where I was at. Faith Home. I said, I got to go speak at a recovery on Saturday night. It was Master's Week back in 2019. He said, well, you didn't ask my permission if you could go. I said, excuse me? He said, you didn't ask my permission. I said, sir, you're probably right, but I got about a week from now. I'm kind of give you a heads up. I run three different departments. I got them all lined up. Everything's good. I'm not really too concerned because, well, I need you here. I said, why? I already know this group you're bringing in. Why are you calling me? Okay. I get back after the weekend. I went and preached. Had 40 men up there at the three or four deep at the altar. 40. And I'm singing, Mercy Walked In. And I've been preaching. And then I go back to work on Monday. You know what he said? I need you to come to my office. Walk in, all these executives are sitting there, and I'm going, oh, it's going to be interesting. He says, we'll give you the week off with no pay, zero, nothing. I said, okay. And then he says, I need you to sign this piece of paper. And he slid it across the desk. I told this before. And I said, okay. I slid it back. HR lady sitting right there to my right. Every one of them in the office were going, you did not just say that to him. I did. Signed it, slid across the table, and I stood up, Shane. I stood up like I was a proud Christian. I knew what was happening right there because God had showed me, today's the day that you leave this place. Amen. Time and season. He said, God's time, not mine. The man looked at me, he said, and I did this right here. He said, what are you doing? I said, I want you to shake my hand. Why? I said, I want to thank you for all you've done for me all these years, 17 years. I appreciate so much what you did. God bless you. So-and-so needs to go where you get your keys and you take the week off and no pay and blah, 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 blah. And you got to do all your schedules. I said, no, sir, schedules. This is December the 17th. I said, sir, my schedules are done all the way through the end of January. I've already looked at everything we got coming into this place. Well, how'd you do that? I said, well, you got other people that know all that. I just call them. They give it to me, and I'll take initiative and be proactive and make it work. He said, you're leaving, aren't you? I said, I didn't say that. You did. And I still didn't say it. The guy we walked with over to my office, he says, you're leaving, aren't you? I said, again, you said that. I didn't say that. Went back to the office, got the rest of my stuff, started praying. Monday morning or Tuesday morning, I got up and went to Social Security office. I said, well, let's see, I'm 64 then. I said, Lord, I had enough, but thank you for pulling me out of it like you did. And the lady said, look here, when you want your check to start? I said, well, not right now. I just want to see what I was going to get. You know, I got a little retirement 401 put up. She says, well, you're going to get this much. I said, she said, when you want your check? I said, I don't want a check right now. I don't need it right now. She said, this is what got me. This is the hook. She said, you're a pastor, aren't you? I said, how'd you know? She said, you are, aren't you? I said, I am a pastor. Why? She said, I'm going to get you $3,000 more a year. I said, I'll take the check next month. True story. That's how you're working, ain't it? Huh? Put the word right in the lap. Good lady. Awesome lady. She really was. Had a great time talking to her. But she was looking after me because God had told her what I was. God, because I didn't tell her. I wasn't there for benefits. I was there to see what I was going to get that I earned all this. I never looked back. That was the best thing I ever did in my life. But nobody's going to tell me that I can't go speak to some folks about the Lord and witness and sing to them, especially some guys that are trying to change their life. I don't care if you're president of the United States. Lock me up. I don't care. Well, Lord, I didn't say that. But bologna sandwiches. I like little oysters. God works miracles in your life if you allow him to. But you see, I went out on a limb. I really did for God. But I was so confident, Tom. I was so confident. I was so excited because I knew I was doing the right thing. And I was sitting there with my chest poked out like this. I'm leaving. Got that right. Thinking to myself, you know. But I shouldn't have thought that. Look, what I'm trying to tell you today, look what all Job went through. I went so many years down there going, God, please take me out of here. Please take me out of here. Please take me out of here. They kept giving me more and more and more and more to do. And gave me more and more money. And I'm saying, God, please take me out of here. I'm tired. And that day he took me out. I knew that was the day. I knew it. As soon as I walked in there, I thought, keep your money.
And then they said to me, well, maybe we can get you your vacation pay. I said, no, you won't. I'm not going to see another penny out of you except my 401. And I know that for a fact because I know how you operate. I'm good, and I never got any of it. I got my 401. Thank God I got that. My wife and I took out some insurance policies. Listen to me, and I'm going to stop with this. Okay? This is just true stuff. This is how God works. Had some policies. We had a critical care policy. See Tabby, by the way, if you need it. Right there. And Tabby comes up to me after Sean had been in what ICU for about a week, maybe. And she says, I need you to get this paperwork filled out. I said, what is it? She said, well, you know, y'all bought this policy, and you're going to get a pretty handsome check just for her being in the hospital. She said, just sign here. So we did. I ain't even thought about that. Not one bit. I ain't thought about the money. I was thinking about her life. But here comes somebody else, a Christian friend, that made sure that we had what we needed to be taken care of. And then on top of that, my wife's got state insurance. Remember her daughter died 2 years ago? On the floor, on the table, at the ER, the hospital. You were there. And they got a heartbeat back in 15 minutes. Look, God don't make no mistakes. He knows exactly what he's doing. So in your life today, do you know what you're doing in your life? Are you truly following God? Are you truly being the person that he wants you to be? Are you truly in love with God? I think that's a bigger question to ask. Are you truly in love with God? If Christians would always come together and work together in one accord. You take all those Christians and put them in one. Everything comes together. God knows what we're doing, when we're doing it. He knows what we need, when we need it. I mean, for goodness sakes, Chris and I, we didn't even know each other. We used to live 20 miles apart for all these years. I was hanging out with the wrong crowd, I guess. Maybe you were. Okay. I'm messing with you, man. I love you. God puts us, we never knew we were going to end up in the same town and do the same kind of thing. That's how God works. Anyway, go ahead, Barrett. Do what you got to do back. We're going to open up this altar, and we're going to open up this altar right here. We're going to open up these two altars today. If you need to come up here today, we'll bring up some of our deacons, some of our folks that want to come pray. Come pray with us. We got to do our best to try to love each other. Do the things that we need to do. Over here, Tina's going to have surgery. Want to be sure we pray with her. Brother Mike's still healing from surgery. Jerry been through some stuff right here. Brother Fred, he's got a lot on him right now. Tammy's just got through a surgery not too long ago. And I mean serious stuff. Brother Jim was put in her life for a reason, and that was to help her walk with God. All the way through her surgery. He knew that was coming before she ever met Jesus. God sent us Rabbi Mike up here. Why did he do that? He did that because he knew that we needed him here with us. Brother Steve, you good? Y'all let the love of God touch you every single day, every single time. Do not walk away from it.
Just as I am, no tossed about with many a conflict, many a doubt,
Call on his name to the storm.
Pray for me because I know all of them.
Yes, definitely.
All fine.
Let's
bow our heads. Father God, we thank you today for what you've done. And Lord, we ask that you will just continue to guide us throughout our week. Lord, thank you for those who are able to be here with us today. Pray they can come back tonight at 5 o'clock. Father, bless the rest of their day, please. Father, I'm just asking again, the hedge of protection around Tina and family and Jerry and all of them. Father, just take care of Tina's surgery. That it's going to be just fine. And that there be no fear in her mind, which there may not be, but God, we're all human, so we're going to have a little bit of fear. But Lord, let her be healed in Jesus' name. Amen. Father, if you would, again, continue to guide us, and we'd hope continue to follow you. Brother Mike, close us in prayer.
Heavenly Father, we thank you for being able to come here. Thank you for being able to worship for you. Thank you for being able to hear your word. Thank you, Father, for the fellowship and for the prayers that you have answered. We give you praise and honor and glory. Let us go out of here being continually aware of your presence, Father, so that we can live as lights in the world. Father, I pray a special blessing upon everyone who is here. And Father, as is our tradition in the synagogue at the end of every service, I want to leave, send everybody out with the Aaronic benediction. Yivarechach Adonai v'yishmarecha Ya'er Adonai ben avelecha v'yechunecha Yisa Adonai ben avelecha v'yasim lecha shalom. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. B'shem Yeshua HaMashiach Tzar Shalom. In Jesus Christ, the Prince of Peace.